today and the first lecture by Laura Ponson from Paris. So it's a pleasure to have Laura again and talking about Samuel Beckett.
So I would like to thank the two organizers for the invitation. It's always a pleasure to come in Chennai. I really like the community, this small fracture community we can meet each time I come here. So I'm going to talk about damage mechanics, continuum damage mechanics. I was very pleased to be invited to talk about this topic. As a physicist, I'm usually coming here to talk about statistical aspects, disorder media, and here I'm coming to talk about a core topic of theoretical mechanics, that is continuum damage mechanics. So actually I'm working in a mechanics department, Institut Jean-Laurent d'Alembert in Paris, that is in Sorbonne University, former called Paris 6 or Pierre Marie Curie University. So let me go into the topics. I'm going to talk about material fracture, but contrary to probably a more topic you may be more familiar with, at least me, who come from that side, we're not going to talk about tensile failure. We're more going to talk about compressive failure. So in tensile failure, you know that the main failure mechanism will be crack propagation. You assume the presence of a defect, and you discuss the stability of this defect, and you discuss the propagation of this so-called crack that will lead to failure. In compressive failure, the phenomenology is very different. In compressive failure, you also assume some defect that may be randomly distributed, and you discuss the evolution of these defects that are, in many cases, micro cracks. And failure takes place through the organization of this micro crack along a plane that we call the localization plane, that also leads to failure, obviously, but through a different phenomenology. So that's the topic we're going to discuss during the three lectures. And so some nice pictures. So in crack problem, in tensile failure, the main object of interest is the tensile crack and its propagation through the media. And in compression, you don't see obviously here on this picture, but you at least see the final localization bend that leads to failure. The object that will interest us are not completely obvious on this picture. There may be micro crack on damage, and I'm going to say what is damage in a minute, that ultimately localize in a plane and lead to the loss of integrity, of mechanical integrity of your specimen. So some general introduction to start about so the challenge is how do you describe in a continuum framework this kind of problems? How do you encode them in a continuum mechanics framework? And as you know, encoding describing fracture by continuum mechanics is always a challenge. Fracture is at the very core taking place at the micro scale through dissipative small scale phenomena taking place at the microstructural scale. So as soon as you want to embed that kind of problem in continuum mechanics, it will be a challenge, and obviously it will be a challenge in damage mechanics the same way it is for a tensile fracture. So a few elements that let us think that actually we can develop a continuum theoretical framework for damage mechanics. The few clues that I'm going to present you are essentially telling us that there are several features that seems to be material independent, suggesting that a continuum mechanics theory that essentially neglect macrostructural feature may work to to describe damage. So that will be the objective of these two coming slides. So first of all, a stress strain response for rock under inertial compression, elastic regime, some softening here, and you go through a peak, and actually it's confined, so it doesn't fully break. It's a confined system, and you reach a stress plateau. And you can track damage evolution using, in that particular experiment, acoustic events. Acoustic events are localized due to thanks to the use of several microphones, and you see that at the beginning of the test, essentially around here, you have randomly distributed events. Then the events start to organize when you are close to the peak, and here, just after the peak, at the so-called localization point, you see that all your events organize in a band that is called the localization band, and here failure is not far. So since here it's confined medium, you don't have failure, but if it was not confined, you will have two pieces. Okay, so I forgot to say, don't hesitate to interrupt for any question or for any comments.
How do these points actually measure?
Okay, so it's the idea. I'm not actually running myself this experiment. Actually, I will in the coming project. But the idea is to use at least three microphones to do triangulation. So you use sensors measuring acoustic emissions. You have waves arriving to your three sensors, and by measuring the arrival time, and be able to say, this event that I receive on microphone 1, 2, and 3 is the same. You can triangulate. Actually, I think 3 is, in theory, you need much more to be precise. And you reach, I think, a reasonable precision, sub-millimeter precision for the location of the events. And you can also register the amplitude of the event, as I will discuss in a minute. Very interesting, in the field of damage mechanics, there are powerful computational methods. You have a method that is working excellently well, is a discrete element model. That is, the idea is to, it's not a continuum mechanics model, it's really to describe a material as an array of beads connected together by elastic forces. And it's a kind of molecular dynamic simulation, except that the elements are representing a mesoscopic volume. It also resembles to discrete models developed by Alex and colleagues. And so you can run numerical experiments where you can observe features that compare very well with the experiment. So this is a stress strain curve.
What is the name of the model?
So the name is DEEM, discrete element models. And it, it looks like granular. I think the difference, instead of having granular media simulation, you will have contact laws. Here, you may have beams that connect each of your elements, and this beam may break if you exceed some stress or elastic energy. And it's rather a phenomenological model. I mean, but as I will present, it captures excellently well the physics. And so we'll use it as a numerical experiments almost. You see a localization pattern that can be observed on this cylindrical specimen. And you have observation of the localization band, essentially here at the peak. All right, so this is the phenomenology, localization of damage beyond some critical load. And you can observe this localization phenomenology in many types of material. surprisingly, suggesting that there might be a common instability mechanism in different systems, or might be, we'll discuss that. In rocks, that was the example, that is the archetypical example of localization under compression. Localization but in rock. You have cellular solids, who have been largely used also to study localization. Here you see in pure compression, you see a horizontal compaction band. In glassy amorphous media, in compression, the failure mode is through localization of damage. So I will see also, depends what you put in the world damage, and even in granular solid. So it's granular solid that is confined under pressure, and you see also localization band. These are bands where essentially the grains are flowing, reorganizing more. It's not, you cannot break a granular solid, it's not like you cannot break a liquid neither, but you can observe the regions that are active, and these are the active regions. And so what is interesting is that the underlying physical mechanism at the very small scale is very different for this material. Still, the failure at the macro scale is taking place through localization, suggesting that there may be something common that is not directly related to the micro scale process. So in rocks, characteristic dissipative micro scale failure processes are micro cracks, but not only. You can have, for example, so I show you here some picture of micro cracks. It's not very obvious, at least here you can see, of a few tens of micrometer. In porous rocks, you might have pore collapse in compression, but these are the characteristic small-scale mechanism you may encounter in rocks. Damage, I will put in the word damage everything that is not reversible. So any dissipative processes taking place during compression. For cellular solid, standard failure mechanism at the small scale is the buckling of the wall of the cell. Beyond some critical load, you have buckling that may actually lead also to failure. More in glass, I'm a bit, how to say, I'm a bit provocative. Huh? Sometimes people don't include these two materials in damage mechanics, but I hear that could be discussed. I'm a bit provocative. So at a small scale in glass, I will argue that these guys share some common processes leading to localization. I will justify that later. At the small scale in glass, you have the so-called shear transformation process, where essentially atoms in the amorphous structure of your glass may reorganize in some region of finite size, leading to plasticity. So plasticity events leading to local rearrangement of your microstructure that is dissipative by essence. And in granular solid, you may see the same kind of rearrangement of grains at a larger scale, obviously, leading also to that correspond to a plastic event and allowing your material to flow. And so,
the angle to be
43. Yeah, it's.
Why not
45? Okay, so the. Well, to be honest, I guess it's an experimental observation of this. It's not.
Shear direction will be 45.
Okay, this will be actually this afternoon. I will discuss in tremendous detail what set the localization angle. Maybe not for glass, as I'm not sure, but I will try to discuss how to predict localization angle. I think it's still something that can be debated. We'll see this afternoon. So the 43, I don't guarantee the 43 here. But apparently it's experimentally observed here. And that's it. All right. So the second interesting aspect is beyond the average mechanical response is the fluctuations taking place before localization. As you know, as physicists, we always believe that there is at least as much information in the fluctuations that in the average response. And for damage, it's also true. So how to observe fluctuation before localization? But once again, you can use acoustic activity. Acoustic activity reflects dissipative processes taking place in your material. And this is the amplitude of the acoustic emission events as function of strain applied, as function of time, if you want. You see, first of all, a lot of intermittency. You see activity even in the even in the seemingly elastic region. And then, as you enter into the nonlinear region of the curve, where you know you have a lot of damage, you see this acoustic emission activity increasing to reach a maximum close to localization. And so the two interesting features are damage doesn't seem to increase progressively, but more through bursts, through peaks, okay? And the second thing is, what I will discuss tomorrow is, it seems to have an increasing activity as you get closer to the localization point.
Does this signal depend upon the strain rate? So in glasses, for example, we know it is more bursty near the small strain rate limit. So
in rocks, I'm not able to say as much. I don't know how this is dependent. Certainly, there will be a slight dependency, but the feature that okay, maybe a very high strain rate, you may lose intermittency. But at reasonable strain rate, you'll see always intermittency and increasing activity. Then you may have strain rate effect that I don't know much.
Strain rates that you use,
These are Bo experiment. It's a very slow. I could not tell. Maybe the test. I know the experiment last couple of hours. Maybe it's. I don't want to throw a number. I don't know, but I can be checked.
-2 per second. Localization is started at that point, or you like specified that localization is only at that point?
Yeah. Okay, so it's a good question. Here, what do you call localization exactly? That's a good point. First of all, these experiments are in a triaxial test, so you don't have access to what's going on inside. Only through this kind of measurement that was shown here, through acoustic emission localization. Okay, what is the exact definition of localization? I will, it's qualitative. It's certainly defined from the peak of the activity. I will define later what I call as a bifurcation, either bifurcation point or localization point. I will define it later.
But we can't say that localization is only at that point. It should be started from that point and it should vary after that.
Okay, so I give you the response right now because it will help. What's going on is that essentially you transit from randomly located to organized event along the band. You'll see in the third lecture, at least I can only give you a theoretical perspective. From an experiment, I think it's difficult, but you have a characteristic size of the zone where damage organizes. You have patches where, as you can see here, all the event takes place during some limited amount of time. These patches, they are organized event taking place, they localize in time and in space. So you have a characteristic time and characteristic length scale. And at the localization point, this characteristic Schlenkel that characterizes the patches of organized events reach the system size. That's my definition of localization. That's the best I can tell you. I don't. We'll see also. Yeah.
Why not a strain rate jump as you cross the band?
Yeah, you can have a discontinuity. It's a good point. That's a good point. Exactly. Because you have a strain. You can have a strain rate discontinuity. That could be also. Exactly. You'll have a continuity of your strain rate along this axis until you cross the bifurcation point. I guess that's a good definition. And then you have a jump also in, and then appear like a discontinuity in displacement. Ultimately, you'll have a crack after this point. Yeah.
From that graph, right? So where that acoustic emission graph drops, from there we can consider that is localization is being started.
Okay. Because also you have acoustic emission activity after localization, for the reason that you may have sliding, life doesn't stop after localization. Things slide, and you might see that as a friction problem. So it's not that clear that everything shut down after localization. Yeah, but you have a signature on the. This is a acoustic emission reproduced in the numerics. You see that as soon as you cross localization, you have another kind of rate of. You see a change in the cumulative acoustic emission. So you might find a way to define it this way also, certainly. Actually, these questions are very relevant. That's the objective of the second lecture. What is localization? What is the mechanism behind localization? Once you have this definition, once you have this explanation, then you can provide a sound definition. Before, you just have a phenomenological definition, but I would say the best is certainly discontinuity in strain rate. In even so, okay, I don't. You might have discontinuity a little before due to fluctuation. So, well, okay. So, talking about events, an interesting observation is related to the statistics of the events prior localization through acoustic emission or here. It was not acoustic emission, it was direct measurement of the events by very precise load measurement. You record the size of the events before localization and you under a very slow strain rate, and you plot the histogram of these events in a log-log scale. So this is a distribution, this is a probability to have an event of size that is 1,000 times larger than the average size event. And you see, in this log-log scale, you find a beautiful power law behavior corresponding to this curve corresponds to different loading rates. I can't certify there is a lot of variation, but at least four or five loading rates have been used and different distance to localization. So S is mechanical energy released during the events, or also dissipated energy during the events for damage is millijoule. And this I will provide you a clear definition later, what is a damage event. But it's in joule. Essentially, they measure, they track the elastic energy stored in the sample at any time, and they see they track the mechanical energy, and they see decrease through jumps.
I've
been cleaning a little bit the noise for my drawing here. So there is noise here.
There's noise, but it doesn't increase as we go to the right here, which tells me that this should not be logarithmic bending.
facilitator.
Yeah.
Then you should see
No, it's a good point. No, I think they use a logarithmic binning, yeah.
Which means
but they correct it by the binning size.
Then it's 2.4 if you have used linear
binning. No, but they correct by the, I think they take care of that. They correct by the binning dimension. I mean by the box dimension, I guess. No, that's, I'm pretty sure. I see what you mean, but they corrected that. Yeah. So they found 1.4, which is a rather classical exponent in the business, as you close to 1.5, but this is the discussion of tomorrow. So interesting observation, power law behavior with another observation was done on the waiting time between events. And this waiting time was explored, the distribution of waiting time between events was explored for several materials. And these guys were able to, David Sen and co-worker, were able to collapse different curves on the same master curve for the waiting times. And with a cutoff here, exponential cutoff, and a power law before with an exponent much smaller. So I'm not going to spend too much time on that. Will be tomorrow, devoted exactly to that. My main message here, it seems to have, damage spreading seems to be reminiscent of, seems to be, so show some general property indicating that there may be a common mechanism behind damage spreading in materials. And we are looking for this mechanism. What is common? How come there is some common things on the fracture of different material? And this mechanism, can we embed it to develop a theory of damage spreading and failure? That's really the objective of damage mechanics. Okay, so I will organize my course in three lectures. Today I'm going to talk about continuous damage mechanics, local models. I'm going to essentially derive a damage criterion and derive the constitutive laws of a damaging solid. Essentially, I'm focused on one material element that is damaging and derive its stress strain response. Okay? We'll see that it's not enough to understand localization. At least, until now, I think no one will debate. The rest is editorial choice. Is a bit. I will defend that understanding the mechanical response of one material element is not enough, and that localization emerges from a collective response of all these elements. And this you need to include to develop so-called non-local models. Essentially, you need to take care of interaction between material elements to understand localization. This is something I will try to convince you later in the afternoon. And tomorrow, we address the question of damage spreading in heterogeneous materials and the question of the precursors. Where does the statistics emerge? Keeping in mind that actually the mechanism behind the precursors is actually the same than the mechanism responsible for localization, as also I will argue. And so for today, regarding the local modeling, so how one material element behaves during damage, I will do that in three steps. The first one is come back really to the basics, thermomechanics of dissipative processes, to derive a damage criterion. And introduce the quantity relevant to predict damage growth. The second part of my presentation this morning is how you go from the damage criterion to the stress strain response of a material element in monotonic loading conditions, so constantly increasing displacement or stress. And then I discuss at the end the non-monotonic loading path. All right, so let's start. So, okay, so damage. First thing to define is damage. So, damage, as I said before, is any process that is dissipative, irreversible, taking place in the material. It could be a lot of different things, and it varies a lot from one material to another. And the idea at the continuum scale is translate microscopic damage processes, typically micro crack, into a variable defined at the continuum scale that we call D of X, if you have a damage field. So D will be a continuum variable, that internal variable, that describes the state of damage in your material. So the way you could picture it is that you have a continuum description of your damage field, that is D of R, and one material point. If you zoom in this material point, you will see, in the case of a microcracking solid, a lot of microcracks. And D will be representative of the concentration of microcracks. You have actually, obviously, you have a choice on how you define D. You can, what counts to translate microscopic damage processes into microscopic damage into continuum scale damage, D. And the main actually interest is to have an internal variable that will, and I will present that later, D will affect the elastic property of the solid. So, well, in some micromechanics model, it is relevant to define D as a density of microcracks. But it's not compulsory. You could find D, all what I'm going to say, D, you can define the way you want. It should characterize the state of damage in your material. But it turns out that for microcrack solid, the most relevant definition is the density of microcracks. And let me define the density of microcracks. So it's a volume occupied by the microcracks, essentially C cube, where C is the crack length, the macro crack length, the sum of the C cube divided by the total volume. So I think an intuitive idea for D is the volume occupied by the macro crack divided by the total volume. It will be, it's a possible definition, but that is indeed practical. It could be also seen as the average of the cube of crack length multiplied by the density of microcracks per unit volume. Okay? So this is a continuum state, it's a variable defined at the continuum scale. And as you can see, if there is no microcrack, D equals zero. So D indicates you, D equals zero indicates you perfectly sane material. And as D increases, more and more microcracks, more and more damage, you'll see that D equal one is not a limit necessarily. You can go beyond, depend a bit on your definition of D, but definitely D increasing indicates damage increase in your material. So you introduce this damage variable, and the main question is obviously, how are you going to predict the evolution of your damage for a material element D, but in a general case, you want to predict the damage field. That is even more challenging.
So what is the macro scale? The macro scale, is this element is homogeneous?
Okay, so here it was for heterogeneous material. That's why you have that's a good point. It was a simulation for heterogeneous resistance to damage. I introduced that later. But if you have a homogeneous material under homogeneous loading condition, D should be a constant until localization. Then localization will be the moment where D become heterogeneous. Say it again?
This macro scale model is inhomogeneous.
Okay, this is a question of length scale. So what is my mesoscale volume? Typically will be 100 microcube. In one material element, I have one value of D. But then, at a scale of a sample that is a meter scale, I can be heterogeneous. I can have a damaged state that is different here than here. So I will be able to describe damage variation from one material point to another. So I will have a damage field that can be heterogeneous. But now I enter in the field of micromechanics. I have mechanical fields, like damage field, stress field, strain field. They can be heterogeneous, but everything takes place at the continuum scale. And obviously it's way more practical to encode that in a theoretical framework. All right, so how do we derive a criterion for damage growth and to tell something about D? When does it increase? When does it remain stable? So the most powerful framework, as you know, is thermodynamics. You're going to be able to discuss evolution of a state variable without knowing much about the system. As you will see, you will not need to know anything about microcracking processes to derive a criterion for damage growth. This is the power of thermodynamics, where you look things, where you look at balance of energies to predict evolution laws of internal variables. So what is the system we consider? We have a microcrack solid, a damaged solid characterized by its damage field, submitted to a force F, applied with a displacement, correspondingly you have a displacement delta imposed. Actually we work under imposed displacement for the demonstration, and it is in balance with the environment that is at temperature T0, and we consider slowly evolving system, slowly driven system, so that temperature will essentially remain close to T0 in the solid 2. Okay. And so then we use first and second principle. First principle, you introduce the internal energy state function that depend only on the state. You have introduced an internal variable D that is characterizing your damage state, and you have loading condition that I'm going to control. I'm going to control my sample in displacement. So my internal energy depends on two quantities, and you know that you can write the variation of this internal energy as the sum of energy transfer through heat and energy transfer through work. There is only these two guys. And so you get U dot, where dot means variation in time, equal to the rate of transfer of energy transferred by heat, and the rate of energy transferred by work. And the energy transferred by work, in our case, was the only force applying on my sample is here, is F delta dot. Okay, so this is energy conservation. And the second principle is relates to entropy. So you know you have a second state function called entropy, but also depend here in the two only parameter of my problem, delta and D, that is going to be decomposed in two parts. A reversible part that is the entropy exchange with the exterior, that in the case here only through heat with the atmosphere, that is Q over T naught, and created entropy. Created entropy taking place if you have irreversible processes taking place in the limit of very slowly varying. We don't discuss that. We know one thing, it's positive. We only create entropy. This is second principle. So you have this inequality that I multiply T naught everywhere here. I have T naught S dot minus Q dot must be positive. Okay, and then you combine these both equation to get an inequation on U dot. Okay, you have T0 S dot plus F delta dot minus U dot must be positive. First and second principle combined together provide you this inequality. Okay, what do we do with that? Then the trick is to introduce another state function called the MMOS free energy that you define properly so things going to arrange well here. And this is also a state function, meaning that it depends only on the state variable delta and d because it's a sum of two state functions. So it's fine. It's u minus t naught s. You differentiate with respect to time. You have the variation of the free energy. It's a variation of u minus t0 variation of entropy. And then you inject in this equation. So now the inequality is on the LMOS, is on the free energy, and you have f delta dot minus the variation of free energy must be positive. All right, so here comes the important step. You want to apply this inequality and to derive a damage criterion, you want to have an expression of your free energy as a function of delta and d. How are you going to do that? You're going to use the fact it's a state function. And so you're going to say that for some given delta and d, that's here, for some given delta and d, if I want the free, oh, it's even here, the free energy at some given delta and d, I'm going to calculate in two steps. First step, I have applied no force. I have no damage. So my reference free energy is zero. First step, which one is first? Yeah. First of all, I introduce a micro crack. But I introduce at zero force. So you have, it's a thought experiment. You have to imagine now that you going to break each of the bonds here and separate each of the bonds from a distance that is sufficiently large so they don't interact, but without affecting the elasticity of your material. And so essentially you introduce free surfaces in your material with a density d. And so your the energy that it costs you can be computed from this expression. It's not in red, applying in red, but here what I've express, I have differentiate the free energy. And since it's a function of two variables, there is two terms. The first one is delta dot times the derivative of the free energy with respect to delta at fixed d. And the second term is d naught times the derivative of the free energy at constant delta. And here the term that is relevant is this one. Okay? Because here I have delta dot equals zero. This term is zero, so the variation of free energy is the integral of this term from d equals zero to d. And so the variation of this term is going to be d times what I call a term defined this way, that is called the damage energy. Essentially, this is the variation of internal energy. You can recognize that only the internal energy will contribute here. Because there is no entropy variation in that problem. So this is a variation of internal energy. This is actually the energy you need to bring to create this interface. It could correspond to a surface energy multiplied by the number of, by the area. Essentially, this is something like that. This is the area of your crack multiplied by the surface energy. But this is, YC is defined by unit volume.
So this is in the absence of any.
In absence of any deformation, that's it. Yeah, it's a thought experiment. It's a thought experiment that you are able to you are a little daemon going to cut the bonds and introduce free boundaries, and the cost to that is the energy. Is the energy of your bonds. Even so, story is a bit more complex. Yeah.
What you're doing is loading it classically and then bringing it back to the reference state. Is it planned?
No, right now I'm not loading them. I'm just creating free interfaces. But you're right. No, I'm loading them. So second step, I'm loading this elastic material with free interface. And when I'm loading it, I'm only inserting elastic energy right now. I don't break anything. So the variation, the second variation in free energy relates to elastic energy. What is the elastic energy from zero force to positive force? And this is this term here. This is the variation of elastic energy. So I have used, it's always a trick you use in thermodynamics. I have used a specific path that looks a bit exotic here, but allows me to calculate the variation of free energy from the state zero force, zero damage to some given force, so some damage. It's constituted of two terms. The damage energy, this is the resistance to damage YC multiplied by the damage D, and the elastic energy. And now if you use any other path, since it's a state function, this will be equal to this quantity. In particular, in most cases, you will, things will happen at the same time, okay? You load, you crack, and everything is... So this is your expression for the free energy, and you differentiate it again. You differentiate it, you have three terms. You have yc times d dot, that is here, and you have two terms related to the variation of the elastic energy with respect to d and with respect to displacement. This term is well known. This is delta dot times the variation of elastic energy with respect to delta at some fixed d. This is the force. This is, by definition, the force. You recognize this term. And this term will be f delta dot. It's here, f delta dot. This one is the variation of elastic energy with respect to d. Essentially, if I increase the number of microcracks, what is the variation of elastic energy? This is the key term. This is really the central term. I define it as y. This is my definition. Is y is the variation of elastic energy when d increase, when damage increase. As I will show you in the following, when you increase the number of cracks, the elastic energy drop at constant displacement. So I put a minus. Okay? So I have a minus y delta dot. And this one was my definition. What is the energy I need to bring to create the microcracks? This was ycd dot. Okay, we are almost done because you have the expression of your free energy that you plug in that. Okay? You'll see right away that this term is going to kill. And you have only two terms remaining. You have d dot times 1 minus yc. Here we are. Where actually I have defined 1 and yc. Yeah, go ahead. No? So.
What was the definition of yc?
Oh, yeah, yc is yc times d is the energy, is a variation of internal energy from going from going to. Hopla. To this. So to create at zero force, to cut bones and to create microcracks. So yc times d is to get a damage at a level d. Here, when I write ycd, I assume that yc is independent of d. Yc cannot be a function of d, then it's an integral yc of d d dot. Exactly. Yc, as you can see, as you can feel, Yc is a material dependent property. If I break a gel, a rock, it will not be the same. Okay, Yc is a material property. And Y? Yeah, and Y is a strain energy released. Y is defined here, is how much elastic energy is released when I introduce this interface. It says an elastic calculation. And as I will show later, elastic energy will drop if you introduce, at under fixed delta, if you introduce microcrack. Okay, this is the criterion. What do we do with that? We have two, we have first of all D, I forgot to mention it. We talk about irreversible processes, so D can only increase. I don't consider the case where you can have healing. Okay, so D increase and D dot is necessarily positive or zero. So if I have that, then I'm remain with two options. If D dot is zero, sorry, if D dot is positive, so if damage increase, I have y larger, actually, I have y larger than yc. I'm missing, realize that I'm missing one equation here to be completely correct, but this is under the assumption that entropy is created, strictly positive, or positive or equal. If I take non-entropy, if I take slowly evolving quasi-statically system, I can have the equality. But, bon, so in that case, D dot positive will imply me y equal yc. So, if D dot is positive, is the damage is growing, y must be equal to yc. This is my criterion for damage. If D dot, if y is smaller than yc, this is clear here. If y is smaller than yc, I have a negative guy here. To ensure this equation, I must have d dot equals 0. Okay? So, actually, I don't demonstrate the equality here. It's an inequality like that. To have the equality, you need to work a little more. But if y is smaller than yc, d dot has to be 0, no damage. If damage is growing, y must be larger than yc. And actually, if you have balance, if you assume non-entropy creation, you have y equal yc. Okay, so what does it mean, all that? You compare two quantities. Y is the rate of elastic energy released when microcrack creates. And this can be calculated from elasticity problem. I have a set of microcracks. I increase a little bit the concentration under fixed displacement. What is my new elastic energy? It decreases, and I get this rate of elastic energy. Depends on geometry of the sample, elastic property, loading condition, and so on. This one is a variation in yc, is a variation of internal energy when d increase. This is a material property. How much energy I need to inject to microcrack the system. Rate of energy dissipated by damage. And so what I'm saying here is that the growth of damage that only takes place when this rate of elastic energy released is equal to the rate of energy dissipated is a vision where damaging a material is exchanging mechanical energy into damage energy. And the transaction can be done only if there is equality. If the rate of elastic energy released is not enough to damage, nothing happens. This is for me, I don't know, this is for me comfortable because this is like exactly like fracture mechanics. In fracture mechanics, you predict crack propagation and you derive the same criterion comparing two quantities, the elastic energy release rate G and the fracture energy GC. The fracture energy GC is somehow simpler in crack. Fracture energy is how much energy I need to bring to create two new surfaces. It's quite clear. It's two times the surface energy somehow. And you have the same criterion, but if G is smaller than GC, you have no crack propagation, and G equals GC, crack propagation. And failure is seen as a transfer of mechanical energy into fracture energy. So this will be this is the general framework. You'll see, I'll discuss that this afternoon, that sometimes it's not the framework that is used. Sometimes it's more a stress criterion that is used, but we'll discuss that.
Y is equal to yc is an equation of damage size.
Damage size. Alors, that's another question. You ask what is... it's a question I didn't address, is do you create microcracks or do you grow existing microcracks? Completely open question. Actually, I have some data, I've studied that. You can study that at the micro scale, counting cracks, their lengths.
If the damage growth depends on the surface energy release rate, right? But here you are talking about rate of elastic energy release. So it would be more related to nucleation of damage size.
Well, I would say both will cost you. Propagating will cost you. nucleating a microcrack will cost you, and this that is magic and that is a weakness of the approach, it's plugged into YC that you measure, but you cannot predict. So indeed, really until today, there is a missing link between YC and the process of microcrack growth, microcrack nucleation, because no one is able to count exactly how much micro. There is still an open question, but at the continuum scale, you don't really care. You can measure YC, it's in joule per meter cube. It accounts for that two processes. And both processes are dissipating energy. Okay, so now we have a criterion in terms of a driving force for damage Y and a resistance to damage YC. How do we make prediction on the stress strain curve? So let's take a material element. We have considered imposed displacement, but for a material element, it's equivalent to consider. Material element. Let's take a specimen that is homogeneously loaded. You have a strain field, derivative of elastic energy under constant delta, I think you are convinced of that, is equivalent to derivative of elastic energy under constant strain field. It's the same thing. So we move to imposed condition to stress field in your specimen. Y is still the variation of elastic energy. And what is the important feature is that when damage increase, the elastic constant of your solid will vary. That's really the core idea that macroscopic damage have a mechanical signature, and this mechanical signature is change in elastic property. Here,
compliance will reduce.
Yeah, from so Poisson ratio will increase, okay, but Young modulus will decrease. And if you plug shear, bulk modulus, they all decrease. Poisson ratio is a kind of exception, doesn't really represent the stiffness, but any elastic constant representing the stiffness will decrease, meaning that the sample is more compliant when it has more damage, microcracks. And what does it mean? It means that the elastic energy that is in this simple case is epsilon squared times the Young modulus. This mechanical energy under constant strain field will decrease when damage will increase. Okay, so this quantity will be positive. So it's like, once again, in fracture mechanics, when your crack grow under some fixed displacement, you release elastic energy. Same thing for damage. When damage grows, you release elastic energy, and this elastic energy is going to be used for micro-cracking your material. But this exchange taking place, or that's a picture you can use to describe that process.
Young's modulus is more related to electronic configuration of the materials. So you are not changing the electronic
configuration. Okay. It is. Don't forget that now. You are talking about the effective elastic property of a material element made of hundreds of microcracks. That's how it can work. So you talk about an effective elastic property of a microcrack material element. Inside, it's heterogeneous itself. Remind you the first picture where you have a damage field and you zoom, you take a material point and you have microcrack inside. So this Young modulus is the effective Young modulus of a microcrack material. It's not representative of a local Young modulus that you could calculate from ab initio, from atomic calculation, because it represents the fact you have broken bones, normal bones, and the configuration of your cracks. It's all right. So more generally, will work in terms of bulk and shear modulus. You can decompose the elastic energy in a term, in two terms. This term is related to deformation under conserved volume and proportional to shear modulus, and this term is proportional to the bulk modulus. And there has been some very courageous fellows who calculated how this elastic constant change as a function of the density of microcracks for a linear elastic material with randomly oriented microcracks in 3D. What is the expression? The bulk modulus and shear modulus normalized by the reference shear and bulk modulus. This guy may be related to ab initio calculation. This one are for the purely intact material. K0 and mu0 are the elastic constant for the purely sane material. But the effective one is a function of D. It will decrease. It's 1 minus something that is positive. It will decrease when D increases. Here you have a mu0 that is the Poisson ratio for intact material. Once again, maybe calculated from atomic structure. And theta is defined also from mu0. So it's a nasty expression, a nasty calculation. And actually, it's not. People don't use that. People use simpler expression. Because damage is often not as simple as randomly oriented microcracks. You have many other dissipative processes that may not be included in that calculation, but it's an interesting model system. But we're going to use it to show you an example. I'm going to use it. So how do you go now to the stress strain response? But you know y is defined from the variation of elastic energy. So let's compute the elastic energy. 1/2 of epsilon 2. Sigma. And you use Hooke's law to relate deformation field to stress field, where I introduce for practical purposes the coefficient A and B that are other elastic constants defined from Young modulus and Poisson ratio. And I plug this expression into this one to have the elastic energy as function of the stress field, where you can see that this stress field that is in the tensor shape, that is going to become a scalar through the trace of the either through the trace of sigma or through the trace of sigma square. This is the expression of the elastic energy. This is very general. Elastic energy for a linear elastic solid, except that A and B are elastic constants. They depend on D. They depend on the damage parameter. And then you differentiate. So the trick you use here, we define that y is the variation of elastic energy under fixed deformation. You can show, and this is an important relationship, that is minus the variation of the elastic energy respect to D at constant stress field. So I don't know if I'll have time to demonstrate that.
Why are you dealing only with the geometric component? Why are you
no, I think I don't deal with only, except if I did a mistake, I think I have all the components.
No, for the elastic.
Ah, yeah?
Remove the trace of sigma. That is, you're only dealing with the...
No. Trace of sigma is not zero. No, I keep it. I don't throw it away. Trace of sigma is not zero. Where do you see? I assume that. I think it's except if I mean, I think it is. This is a general expression for the elastic energy of the linear elastic solid. No. Trace of sigma is non-zero. But you're right. This is if it was trace of sigma zero. This is a pure non. The conserved volume part of the elastic energy, you're right. Alright, so this relationship that I may justify a bit later is straightforward from this expression actually. It's very practical. It means you can differentiate the elastic energy with respect to D for fixed sigma. So we can use the expression here. Sigma is fixed. And you differentiate with respect to D that is only present in A and B, in the elastic constant. So it gives you right away this expression. A prime divided by 2 time trace of sigma to the square, b prime plus b prime over 2 time trace of sigma, everything to the square, where a and b are here, and they can be they are related to d. And actually, what do I do? You could, you know that there is a relation between mu and e and k on mu. So you could use the expression k on mu that are here, plug it there, and get a and b as function of d. It would be certainly a nasty calculation, but you can do that. And then, what is sigma? But then, sigma is given by your stress state that depends on the loading condition. So we're going to consider an example of uniaxial compression, and then the stress state is homogeneous and is simply minus sigma x times this matrix with only one on the upper left corner, and pure shear. But I represent this way by a sigma x like that, compression here, and no, it's traction, sorry. There is one, it should be traction here, sorry. Compression and traction here. It gives you minus x here and minus sigma x here and sigma x here. So sorry, this arrow are outside. And so you plug this into that for these two examples, you see right away that the sigma x is going out. So the elastic energy release rate is always in sigma square. But this is an energy release rate. It's always in sigma square or epsilon square, where sigma epsilon are the loading applied to your specimen. That's normal. And then you have a function of d that will depend on how elastic constant depend on d. But this can be, in principle, done even for the model of microcrack solid. And the second ingredient you need is the resistance to damage. So there, a simple option will be to take a constant. Yc is a material property, and I will give you a characteristic number at the end of the presentation. But you could also take what we call a hardening material. The more you damage it, the more difficult it is to damage. This is a model choice here. You can obviously debate it. We can measure. We have measured that in some material, and indeed we found that this linear relationship was reasonable. It means that, once again, the more you damage the material, the more resistant it is. And the physics behind can be discussed if you want. So then the damage criterion is y equal yc. You say that d dot is going to be positive, y equal yc, and it will give you d as function of time, and in particular it will give you d as function of sigma x. So you have y equal sigma squared times small y of d time yc, equal yc, sorry, and you solve that in d. So you can get d as a function of sigma x. And for the deformation, you use Hooke's law. Hooke's law gives you the relationship between sigma, epsilon, elastic constant, but elastic constant depends on d, so it gives you epsilon. Okay.
Laura, we should finish in 5 minutes.
Oh, sounds good. Sounds good. So for uniaxial compression, so we have done that numerically. For uniaxial compression, for eta equals 0, this is the curve here. So you have elastic response, d dot equals 0 in that region, because in that region y is smaller than yc, y is proportional to sigma x. So sigma x increasing, I have y equal yc here, and then d increase, and I have a parametric curve, sigma x of d, epsilon x of d, that gives me this response. Obviously, it's not realistic, I have a snapback here. It may not follow that. If you are in constant under applied strain, you will go here, here, and here. At the maximum, you will fall down. Okay. And if you increase the hardening coefficient, you'll see that you may have a hardening region in your curve. That is more representative of real response under uniaxial compression until peak load that are represented by dot. Everything that is after for this kind of model can be debated. This I'll discuss this afternoon. This model is not able to handle what is there. There is a bifurcation problem and so on. So strictly speaking, you stop at the peak load. And under pure shear, you can make the same kind of prediction as function of different value of eta, going from softening to hardening response. Okay, then you can, I was saying this model is very nice to go from the micro crack density to elastic property. You can take actually whatever micro mechanics model you want, in the sense that you can choose how the elastic constant depend on D. You can measure them or assume that. So, for example, you can assume that the Poisson ratio remains constant and that the Young modulus decrease as an exponential of D. Classical model is E0 times 1 minus D, but this one is a bit pathological because as you derivate twice, you get zero. So exponential is making a better job. This is the elastic constant A and B for the two models. The randomly distributed microcracks in black and this new model in blue. There was an interesting observation that for the randomly distributed microcracks, Young modulus become negative for D larger than 0.4. So the model cannot accept value of D larger than 0.4. It's normal. If you have too much microcrack, it's normal. I think it's also a calculation method that may be limited, but it also makes sense that if the microcracks are too dense, you may lose rigidity, or not very sure about that, but certainly you should not go beyond D equal 0.4. And then for this model, as you can see, D can be very large, and you will have your elastic constant as function of D. It's A and B are inversely proportional to D, to E, sorry. So increasing function means stiffness decreasing. So as you go to larger D, the stiffness decreases. And you can predict this model, once again, stress-strain behavior under uniaxial compression and pure shear. You see that for this model, you have extended hardening region, and the behavior is more damage growth takes on a longer range of value of strain. So I will conclude here. Two main ingredients in a damage model: how elastic property are affected by the damage parameter. I would say even zero. You need to define a damage variable. For microcrack system, it's quite obvious. For other, you may introduce whatever. Yeah, you may introduce your own estimate of the damage level. Then you have to predict how elastic property depend on this damage parameter. And the general trend is that damage increase leads to softening. Stiffness will decrease. And the question is damage energy. This is a quantity that is not up to date, but you cannot predict from a given material. A bit the same thing than the fracture energy. No one is, well, it's not easy to predict fracture energy from a given microstructure. And so this kind of model let us with some open question yet. But what is more important is that this is valid for this is valid here. We assume that all material elements behave the same. We have homogeneous loading condition, and we have assumed that all material elements behave exactly the same. The specimen response is the one of the material element. I've made no differentiation. So we'll see that the state of the system will bifurcate at some point, and localization will take place, meaning that all the material elements will not behave the same, and damage will localize into some damage element. And this is the afternoon lecture. Thank you.
Three questions. lunch. So we meet again at 2 o'clock. Right?